Good afternoon. Welcome to the 2017 Sloan Sports Analytics Conference. My name is Sean Singer. I'm a first-year MBA student at the MIT Sloan School of Management. We're here today for our Win the Game Day panel presented by Zebra Technologies. We're joined by Sam Ventura, professor of statistics at Carnegie Mellon University and a consultant to the Pittsburgh Penguins. Mitch Tanney, director of analytics for the Denver Broncos. Ben Falk, former vice president of basketball strategy for the Philadelphia 76ers. John Bacon, director of operations for Zebra Technologies. Ben Lindberg, a staff writer and podcast host with The Ringer. And our panel today will be moderated by Chris Herring, a senior writer at ESPN. The hashtag for this panel is WinningGD, so please submit your questions to our panelists via Twitter. Thank you.
All right. Well, hello to everybody. I hope you guys are doing well and enjoying the conference so far. We have this great panel. It's really cool to be able to ask you guys questions about, you know, as a reporter, to hear about how you guys implement some of the stuff that I find so interesting to write about. So we'll just go ahead and get started. I'm really curious from all of you guys what you see as the area that the particular sport that you guys are involved in, what can impact the game the most in terms of if there's not necessarily one number, but is there one thing that you look at and you can immediately tell this might be going off the rails or this is how we can fix what's happening? Is there one thing that you look at? I guess we'll start with Sam in terms of over the course of a hockey game. What can you look at that you say we can impact this right away if something is kind of going off the rails?
Sure. I think that's a pretty tough question to answer in hockey. From game to game and from shift to shift and period to period, there's just so much randomness in the sport that it's really hard to say, you know, there's one number or one statistic or one aspect of the game that's really the thing that's driving what's going to happen, you know, in the next shift or the next period or the next game.
Sure. So. How do you make a decision on something like, you know, we obviously see teams pull a goalie at the end of a game. How do you make a decision on when to do that? Is there anything? Is it a feel? If it is a feel, how do analytics kind of help inform that sort of thing?
Yeah, I mean, you can calculate the optimal time to pull the goalie under certain assumptions, but I think the key word there is assumptions. You know, there's a lot of contextual factors throughout the course of a game that, you know, if you calculated that the optimal time to pull the goalie was 90 seconds left, what if the puck's in your own end? What if your best players are tired? You know, there's a lot of things you have to take into account there that make it not quite as clear an answer as, you know, some of the public research might suggest.
And lastly on that sort of thing, even if you felt like there was an optimal time to be able to pull a goalie or make some sort of important choice like that that you would make, how is that sort of thing relayed to a coach? Like if you say there's 120 seconds left, there's 2 minutes left, and then we want to do it right around 90, you might be thinking that how's that sort of thing communicated to somebody who might not be right next to you?
Sure. So I think it's important to have a coach and a coaching staff who are open to these types of ideas. You need buy-in on these types of ideas from throughout the organization. And I think if you have that, then it's not as much of a concern. And if you don't, then maybe that's something that you know, different organizations might struggle with more than others.
Okay, thanks. Ben, I was going to ask you the same question about, well, I guess we got two Bens here, so I'll be better about that. Ben Lindberg, how do you go about that with something like with baseball? What do you see as, here's something where we can really stem the tide if we're struggling? Is there anything like that that you...
Yeah, I mean, paradoxically, baseball is probably the most set-it-and-forget-it sport of all of these, possibly, even though it's the most data-rich, possibly, also, and lends itself to extensive analysis. Once the game starts, you can't do all that much to control, you know, who's coming up at the important moment. You set the batting order, and then that dictates who comes up, and you set your starting pitcher, and that dictates who's going to pitch the most innings. And so that's why you have stories about managers falling asleep on the bench, because there's just only so much they can do, and a lot of the things they can do might actively hurt. So I think there are two barriers, really. One is the structure of the sport, and then the other is technology, and baseball hasn't really embraced, you know, no one's wearing headsets and communicating with the dugout and the bench or the front office. And you can have iPads in the dugout, but you can't have internet-connected iPads. And so there's only so much analysis you can do during the game. And so I think pitching changes are probably the most significant move that you can make in a game, and probably also the thing that lends itself to real-time analysis. If you can see that a guy's arm angle is dropping, or his spin rate is declining, or his velocity is dipping, and you know in the past when he's tended to tire, you can make a real-time calculation, and you can look at those pitches the second he throws them, and you can say it looks like he's fatiguing, and maybe we should get this other guy up. You could even set up a system in the bullpen so that you could see it looks like this reliever has good stuff today. Maybe we bring him in now. So you can make that kind of calculation. I guess the question is, how do you communicate it to the dugout if you can't call down and you can't, you know, relay things directly to the player without stopping play? And so that's something that teams are still figuring out. And so, you know, a few years ago there was this story about how a mystery team was using a supercomputer for some mysterious purpose, and everyone speculated that it would be real-time data like that, looking at players, are they getting tired? You can make decisions about substitutions, and that's probably the biggest area that you can make a difference. You know, get a guy out at the perfect moment, even detect an injury a little bit early. There was an article that was published at the Hardball Times in 2009 called The Injury Zone by this analyst named Josh Kalk, and he used that in-game pitch FX data to say, well, his arm angle's dropping and his velocity's declining, and this is a risk factor. This is what it looks like when a guy's about to get hurt. And then that guy was hired instantly by the Tampa Bay Rays. So in the public sphere, we don't have a great handle on what exactly teams are doing in that area, but you know they're doing something.
That's great. Okay, and for Ben Falk, who did stuff with the Blazers and then most recently with the Sixers, what sorts of things? I mean, basketball, a lot of us can watch, and well, maybe it's just me as a basketball reporter. We can clearly see when something's going wrong. I was watching the Warriors last night, and it's like, wow, they really can't hit a three, which is a really weird thing to say about the Warriors. But what sorts of things do you see over the course of the game that you feel like you can implement something that might have a data element to it to kind of fix what's happening?
Yeah, so I think one of the biggest challenges with using in-game statistics is that the samples are so small.
Sure.
And so, you know, as a coaching staff, you might go into the game thinking, okay, this is our strategy, this is what we're gonna try to do, and it doesn't seem like it's working at first. And that's the moment when you have to figure out, okay, is this the kind of thing where it's just a small sample size, it's just, you know, they hit a couple open shots or we blew our coverages? Is this something we want to stay committed to? Is this our philosophy where we need to execute it better? Or do we make an adjustment? And those aren't necessarily, I mean, those are probably the hardest things to answer with data, just because those samples are so small and those situations can be so unique. And so a lot of that comes down to the philosophy of the coaching staff. You know, do they believe, they're watching it and they're saying, okay, you know, is it an execution problem? Is it a strategic problem? Did we miscalculate going into the game? And you know, depending on the answer to that, that's how you have to make that adjustment. I don't know how easy that is to do from a statistical perspective.
Yeah, I there's so many times where you watch a game and I kind of feel like you can tell if something fluky is happening. Oklahoma City played the other day and I think they made their first 12 threes, and I think they're a slightly below average three-point shooting team. And so something like that, if you're defending and even if you're in their face and they're just making shots, you know, the idea of do you stay with that strategy, do you go away from it? And so I could see how that would be difficult for a coaching staff if you really believe in whatever your strategy is in that given game.
Right.
So, Mitch, you obviously are in a sport that is constantly analyzed. I know there are Twitter accounts now that are set up as bots that literally will have an opinion on whether you should go for it on fourth down, where it's just kind of an automated decision. I think the New York Times has a Twitter account like that. How do you all make those decisions? With football, obviously, you guys can communicate with the coach over the course of the game with the headset. But how much input do you all have in those sorts of decisions, or is it something that is somewhat preordained in terms of a certain predicament that you might get into that it makes sense versus not making sense to go forward?
Yeah, I think it's going to depend a lot of the time on the staff and the general philosophy from the coaching staff. But you can certainly have those conversations during the week leading up to the game.
Okay.
We get in this situation, we're tending to lean toward this route. And you try to have those conversations in advance on game day. There's a lot of movement on the field. There are a lot of conversations, there are a lot of coaches, a lot of position coaches, and there's just a lot of moving pieces. And from a data perspective, you try to get a general baseline of, okay, league average is this. then you have to kind of make your decision knowing the strengths and weaknesses of your team. You know, you're talking about fourth down. If you're not a very good short yardage team, you should probably reconsider your fourth down strategy. If you are a good short yardage team, that's obviously going to influence your strategy on fourth down. So, you know, there's certain baselines you can learn and study across the league, kind of what's going on, what's average, and then, but you also need to know the strengths and weaknesses of your team.
When a team calls timeout to have maybe an extra few seconds to think about a fourth down, is it sometimes to figure out if they want to go for a fourth down, or is it mostly based in what play do we want to run on this fourth down?
I think it varies from team to team.
Okay.
I think sometimes the decision to take the timeout is we need more time. I think sometimes, you know, if a team lines up to actually look like they're pursuing the fourth down, they don't get the look that they want, they may take a timeout. So there's a number of, you know, somebody, they may not have the right personnel. Somebody may have gone down. They may not have their third tight end and they wanted to go 13 personnel. So there's a lot of things moving. So sometimes those timeouts, it just depends on the situation.
Thanks. John, what, I mean, you're in an interesting spot now because you go back 20 years ago, less than that, 10 years ago in some sports, data was not necessarily a huge part of the equation.
Yeah.
Maybe for certain teams it was, or it was starting to become that way. Now everybody wants at least a piece of this to understand what advantage they can pick up. What do you find that teams or the league as a whole, what do you find that people are asking of you? What sorts of things can you help them to obtain that may not be out there already in terms of data points or data sets? And how much of what these teams are asking for do you feel like you're able to actually accomplish that are within the realm of what's possible right now?
Sure, absolutely. And really, we've come a long way in a short period of time in terms of the availability of positional data. And I asked Ben about this backstage. What are some of the things he looks at or considers to be kind of game changers? And his answer was positional data or XY coordinates. So now we can deliver within 100 milliseconds the position of every player on the field, on the NFL field, on game day as well as practice. And now you not only have, of course, that data available from your game day, but also potentially from your practice data. So now you're comparing apples to apples. It may not necessarily be data that's available in game to make a decision on the sidelines. As Mitch had mentioned, it's fairly chaotic and you may not necessarily digest that immediately. But as you go through the week and prepare for the next week's game, you have a tremendous amount of data available that never before was achievable. To go into those decision-making pieces and also to evaluate what do we do in this particular situation. And now with the advent of this being collected for several years, as the NFL continues to release this information to the teams, you know, the day following the game and hopefully at some point the ability to look at your competitive data as well, I think it's going to change how those decisions make, maybe not necessarily on the sideline, but certainly as they go into the next week to prepare for that next game.
Thank you. So one thing I'm curious about, we kind of touched on this, Ben, already, about how do you know if something is working or if it's just maybe a fluke that the other team is making shots or something like that. But you worked for the Sixers, obviously. It was a team that struggled over the last few years. Kind of seen some daylight this year, and then Joel Embiid gets hurt. Ben Simmons isn't able to play this year. But in a situation like that where they were kind of very clear about the fact that they were playing for the future and that they had a lot of ideas that were very radically different from a lot of teams. How is that sort of situation different when you're on some level, it was almost like an experiment to some extent. How do you gauge what's working, something that you want to see a lot of to be able to gauge whether it's working? And is that a game-to-game thing? Do you try to give it a certain number of weeks if there's something that you guys want to see and that the coaching staff also wants to try out?
Yeah, so, I mean, I think you're focused on a different time horizon slightly. So instead of necessarily being game to game, you might be looking at larger blocks of time, looking at the progression of players. But also from a coaching perspective, you know, Brett Brown was very focused on building a culture and holding players accountable for the things that they could control, right? And so that's a lot of what you're focusing on too, are things, you know, just effort, you know, getting back in transition, playing the right way, playing the way that as a coaching staff and as an organization that you'd be proud of, right? That you want to build your program for the long term and that ideally will be part of a culture that will carry over for when you get the talent in there. So I think that there's certain indicators, they might be different, you know, from the from when you're at a more competitive part of the franchise lifecycle. But they're still important indicators that you're following and you're trying to track to judge your progress over time.
Okay. Ben Lindbergh, you, for those of you who don't know, co-wrote a book that basically gave him the opportunity to run an independent minor league franchise, baseball franchise, and make the decisions for it for a year. And I'm so curious about some elements of that, but how did that work for you in terms of, you guys probably obviously did want to experiment with certain things, but within that, how long can you give something to see, does this work? Is this just kind of a crazy idea that I have? And within what confines were you doing that? Were you having conversations with players to ask them to try different things, or is that something that you're leaving up to the coaches? Do you talk to the coaches? How does that process work? How long do you give that sort of thing to try out?
So this team is called the Sonoma Stompers, and it's a low-level independent league team. So these are professional players. They're paid to play baseball, and some of them have been in affiliated ball with a major league organization, and people kind of cross back and forth. And so they all dream of making the majors someday. They're realistic. They know it's a long shot, but they take it very seriously, and so we wanted to take their dream seriously and not treat them like, you know, lab rats or something, that we were just running these experiments on them. And so we kind of had free run of this very small organization, so we could sign players, and then we could be in the dugout during games, and we could be in the clubhouse, and we were sort of scouts slash statistical analysis analysts, and it was an unusual role that you don't really see in major sports. And so we found that, you know, the title of the book is The Only Rule Is It Has to Work, and that was our philosophy, is that all that matters is that this tactic is effective. That's all that we care about. If it's unconventional, we still want to try it. But it also sort of had a double meaning, which is that it really did have to work. Like, the first time we tried something,
right,
if it backfired, even if we were confident that in the long run it was the smarter strategy and it would pay off, if it totally backfired the first time and the players know that it's me and my co-author who came up with this idea and we don't have the baseball background, and so, you know, like, the first time we shifted on a guy, no one shifted it at that level of baseball. The first time we shifted on a guy, we thought, these guys have never seen shifts before. There's no way that this guy's going to drop a bunt down right into the empty section of the field. And that's exactly what he did. We talked to him later, and he said he'd been waiting his whole life for someone to shift on him so that he could do that. So we just happened to run into this one guy.
Working on the book.
Yeah. And so we thought, we're done. Like, this is the first time we've tried this. This is the first time many of these players have been on a team that tried this, and it totally spectacularly backfired. And we were lucky that the pitcher later in the game kind of took the long view and said, hey, if you guys think this will work, I'm willing to try it again. Or, you know, when we would bring in a closer in the fifth inning or something, because we thought that was the most important moment of the game, we were really on the edge of our seats because we thought, this will work if we have a season to try it, but we don't have a season to try it. Right. Because if he blows this game right here in this situation he's not used to, and everyone's already questioning why he's in this game, we're not going to be able to try it again. And so it really did come down to these tactics that might or might not work in a single trial. You know, it might be a 55-45 thing, but if you don't get the 55 the first time, you're in trouble.
That's fascinating to me. And you know, the difference between that and Mitch, I think you worked with the Bears before you went to the Broncos, but it's a pretty big deal. John Elway hires you to a team, and I think he studied econ when he was at Stanford, but someone that obviously appreciates numbers, but still to come into a situation like that, and then you guys win a Super Bowl, I wonder how it differs, kind of the confidence level from having 1 year to do something, as long as it works, which is pretty much the title of his book, and then you go to a franchise where you guys win, and, you know, I'm sure there's never a point where you feel totally comfortable, where you feel like, no matter what happens, I'm here for life or anything like that. The NFL doesn't work that way.
No,
but
it doesn't.
But the sort of a little bit more comfort you probably feel in knowing the opposite of what Ben just said, where if we make one mistake, everybody looks at us with this ugly stare, and the idea that you a mistake can happen or something might not go with the odds one time, and you're okay to still try something else or feel the confidence to try something else.
Yeah.
How does that work for you?
Well, let me address the first part about, you know, being hired by the Broncos. And I think anyone that's worked for a team in an analytics role, you're there because someone in the organization thinks that that's going to help them win. So the people that have been in analytics roles with the team, obviously they're hiring you for a reason. They think that you can help them win. And it doesn't work if you don't get that support from the top. So I think anyone that works for a team can validate that. Your second part of your question about?
It was asking, just feeling, not feeling as if any one decision
okay,
that you
yeah,
make.
Yeah, yeah, so the percentages, I kind of want to go back to something that Ben said. You know, if it's 55-45, or is it 52-48, or 60-40, there's a certain threshold, depending upon the situation, where the decision still has to be made whether or not, is that enough of an edge for us, do we think, or is it due to noise? If it's 60-40, you know, obviously you're going to feel a little more comfortable if it's 80-20 or 90-10. But sometimes when it's really close, there is no clear, definitive answer. You know, maybe just due to randomness, you're analyzing a small set of plays, and that's the way the numbers came out that time. That doesn't mean it's going to happen the next time. But, you know, if you take the long view, as Ben mentioned, over time, you hope that those decisions add up to the results you're ultimately looking for.
I guess one thing I'll ask, how involved are you? Are you, during the game, are you involved with talking with the coaching staff as stuff is happening, or do you relay that to someone else? What sort of communication role do you have on game day?
Yeah, so I'm up top in the press box on game day.
Okay.
And ultimately, the stance I kind of take is I try to help where I can.
Okay.
And I think anyone that's in the role actively on game day, first and foremost, you need to respect what's going on and the amount of time and effort that the coaches have spent to prepare for game day, and trying to just hop in that environment and say, well, it's 55-45, therefore we must make this decision, mm-hmm. I think is a bad approach. It's a way to lose trust and just relationships with the coaching staff. So just because it's, you know, it's slightly in favor of one way, that doesn't mean, you know, I kind of go back to, you have to know the strengths and weaknesses of your team as well.
Sure.
So, am I involved on game day? Yes.
Sure.
And to that point, I just want to say, you know, there's a relationship aspect to it. There's also an aspect of how confident can you be in your data analysis, right? The closer the edge is, there's still a confidence interval, right? And you might be wrong. You might also not be taking into account any kind of contextual things that are important and can sway the analysis in the other direction. So humility is helpful, not just from a relationship standpoint, but also for getting it right.
And Sam, actually most of the people on this panel, the interesting thing is that, I'm not sure if all you guys were in these roles before, but the fact that a couple of you guys, I know in Mitch's case, he played football in college and was actually, I think, runner-up for National Player of the Year one of those years.
Small college, let's clarify that.
D3, but still,
small
I mean,
college.
Better than my college career, which was non-existent. But between you having played and a couple of you guys now coach, Sam, how does that help you when you, having some coaching experience, did it, not that anybody goes into it thinking that they know everything, maybe some people do, it's probably not the best way of going about it, but does it give you kind of a greater respect in terms of working with people that have to make a decision on the fly where they might not have the data at their fingertips to know what decision is best to make and why?
Sure, so full disclosure, I coach a D3 ice hockey team, so it's pretty low level and I don't have that much experience. With that in mind, I have a lot more leeway to make those 55-45 decisions. Because, you know, what are they going to do, fire me? Like, who else is going to coach the team if I don't do it? So, contrasting that to the NFL, you know, I think it brings up a really interesting question of incentives. So if you had, you know, an objective, rational utility function, then you would make that 55-45 decision, regardless of how much noise there might be in the data. I think what happens in the NFL in particular is that coaches are sort of have some perverse incentives in the sense that if they make this this unusual decision and it goes the other way, their job could be on the line. And that's a big issue. You know, the fourth down question is one that comes up, you know, pretty much in every single game. It comes up multiple times per year, new analyses showing that you should go for it on fourth down more than coaches currently do, and we still don't see it happening that often. And I think a large portion of that is because, not because the models are wrong, but I think it's because coaches are sort of incentivized to behave in this way that they're, this traditional behavior, these traditional methods of making decisions.
And that part of it is interesting. So that's actually kind of what I wanted to ask John, is that the traditional model is shifting so quickly in a lot of these sports, football especially, when you look at you know, when I first started watching football as a kid, you know, the idea of a 2,000-yard rusher, and now looking at it, and everybody's throwing the ball so much, the rules have changed in a way that kind of incentivizes throwing the ball, makes it tougher on defenses. Have you found that what teams or whoever it is that interacts with you guys, are they asking for things that kind of lean more in one direction of how the game is played, where maybe they're asking for a lot of stuff on what data you have on passing as opposed to maybe rushing is de-emphasized? Or maybe because rushing is de-emphasized, maybe are they asking for more ways to gain an advantage in something that teams are using less of now?
Yeah, I think that's an interesting point. And from what we're being asked to deliver, and I think everyone on the panel can agree, you will never have fewer data points to look at next year, right? So it's always more, what can you deliver to me for this particular aspect of the game? How can you deliver it to me on practice? And I think the NFL recognizes that as well, and they've made some significant investments and actually taken some chances. It's proven out well with the advent of the instrumented football. So this was experimented with in 2016 on Thursday Night Football as well as the preseason games, and it's now going to be rolled out. I think most of you have probably read this by now. It's going to be rolled out for every game in 2017. And I think from that aspect, you're going to get a tremendous amount of interesting data, and it's going to be equally relevant or exceptionally relevant because of the shift in the game, right? Things like, you know, passing speed, velocity, you know, position of players where with caught passes, drop passes, there's going to be so much more available. And I think the NFL's hit it right on the head with where they're going with the next level of statistics that will be available very soon.
Thank you. I wanted to ask Sam a question, just kind of having talked to you guys a little bit before, knowing some of the stuff you guys look at. Like you were saying before, hockey moves so exceptionally fast. Certain things that have been analyzed a certain way before, you have guys that are known to be statistically the best at face-offs, for instance. Mm. What sorts of ways are there that you think are maybe better out there to gauge those sorts of things? What sorts of things can you look at? Because some of that stuff, you know, I guess maybe who gets there, stick to the puck first. You know, that might be one way to gauge it, but it could bounce off someone and then end up with the other team anyway, even if I win the face-off, so to speak. What sorts of ideas are there out there to kind of measure that better than what currently exists, in your opinion?
Yeah, so I mean, I think it's just a matter of what data you have access to. You know, obviously face-offs are in the publicly available NHL databases,
right.
And it makes it really easy for us to try to infer player talent or defensive ability or something like that using things like face-offs that we have. Regardless of what extra information you get from private data sources or for some of the public research projects that are going on now, like the Passing Project and Ryan Stimson, you know, some of the other ones that are happening. I think it's just a matter of trying to value each of those sources of information according to how much they actually contribute to the game. And I think as long as you have that relative value worked out, then it's, you know, not too much of an issue.
I'm always so curious about that in terms of, let's say a team is bad at face-offs. If you go into an offseason and you say, we want to go get someone that's better at it, and that's where I find that sort of thing so interesting, is how much do you weigh certain elements that fall into that? You know, if someone traditionally on a statistical level wins a lot of face-offs, even in a given year, if there's data to kind of counter, you know, it's counterintuitive that actually shows he's not actually that good, he might have a teammate that's just really good at recovering the puck. So there's so much stuff that goes into that. I'm really curious about that. Mitch, going back to what we were saying about you downplayed it, but your D3 football career, there's such a big divide. I know in my sport in particular, in the NBA, there's such a big divide, and there are lots of controversy now over the idea of front offices and are analytics kind of pushing out people that used to play that now want to be in a front office that traditionally have been in a front office. Do you feel like you're able to communicate differently with people because of the fact that you did play, that you said a D3 level, but you were good at that level? Do you feel like you're able to communicate differently because you've seen both sides of it? And do you feel like that divide exists in football the way I was describing in the NBA?
Yeah, it certainly helps. Anytime, I mean, I kind of look at it from both angles. Anytime I can learn more football, great. If I can learn more about offensive line play or defensive line play or secondary or any, you know, fill in any position group, if I can learn more ball, that's going to help my research. If I can learn new research methods and what's going on in the academic community. That's going to help how we implement things on the football side. So it's trying to equally improve at both. The conversations that I have with coaching staff or with coaching staffs and with personnel people, it certainly helps that I played. I was really fortunate. I grew up in a football family. My dad was a high school coach for almost 30 years. So I grew up around the sport. I grew up talking it, watching it, and was really fortunate in that respect. And I think it certainly helped me professionally.
I think there's like I was saying, the perception there that a lot of times it's one or the other. But I mean, even people that might not have played, you know, in college or, you know, at a low level professional league, I think more of us are way more into the sport than maybe we get credit for sometimes.
It shouldn't be, it's not a prereq. It shouldn't, yeah. And it shouldn't be a prereq, because there are a lot of people that are on the academic side that really know the game, but they may be discredited simply because they didn't play, and shouldn't be the case. There's some really talented.
And I know that exists for coaching too. A lot of the time, when someone didn't play at a high level, you know, in their playing days. But I wanted to ask Ben, what? I mean, you had a year to do this. It had to work, as you said in the title. What was the biggest takeaway for you in terms of that? Was it the interpersonal relationships, or was it something on the field that you saw that either did or did not work that you thought would or would not work?
Yeah, I think the greatest learning experience for us was the interpersonal dynamic and trying to find our way and trying to figure out how assertive we should be. We didn't want to come in and act as if we had all the answers and alienate everyone on day one, but I think we found as we went along that we almost played it too safe and deferred a little too much, and we wanted to wait until the samples reached reliability or whatever. That's, you know, we wanted to make sound decisions. And while we were waiting to have that large enough sample, other people were making decisions for us that were then difficult to undo. So, you know, we had a really brief spring training, and at the end we had this discussion about who was going to be our opening day starter. And at that point, we had seen every pitcher twice, and we had almost nothing to go on, really. But there was one pitcher who wanted the job, right? And so he demanded the job, and our manager said, I like that he wants the job. And we didn't have the data to say, no, we can definitively prove that this guy is not the best candidate for the job. So we said, okay, you know, we'll see how it goes. And he turned out to be the worst pitcher on the team. Oh. But because he had that cachet, he had the aura of the opening day starter, people looked at him as the ace, even though he was really ineffective. And so it was difficult to dislodge him from that role just because he sort of seized it on day one. And so as we went on, we learned that you kind of have to act the part to a certain extent. You don't want to come in and be tyrants, but you also don't want to sit on the sidelines because other people will make decisions for you.
That's
fascinating. And we also, I think, figured out how to relate to players more and how to pass on the information we had to them, because, you know, it's a lot to keep in your head when you're going up to the batter's box and you're trying to hit a 90-something mile per hour pitch to know, okay, this guy throws this pitch and that pitch and that pitch, and he throws it this percentage of the time in that count, and he throws it low and away or high and inside. It's just too much for a lot of players to keep in their head and be actively thinking about while they're also trying to do this really quick twitch reflexive activity. And so we would make these scouting reports that we did based on the data that we had collected and the video, and we found that players really like watching video of themselves, not so much when they're not involved in the highlight.
Self-indulgent.
Yeah, and they don't want to see themselves making outs necessarily. They want to see when they had hits. So it's difficult to diagnose what went wrong because they only want to watch the successes, which I understand. But we would fill up these whiteboards in the dugout with scouting reports. And at the beginning of the season, we were just dumping all the data that we had and scribbling on every inch of this thing and just all the information we had collected. And some players sort of took us aside and said, you know, this is great. We've never had anything like this before, but this is overkill. This is too much for us to keep in our heads. So as the season went on, the information got more and more condensed, and it would just be, you know, this is, you got to worry about the breaking ball with this guy, or, you know, like, two takeaways maybe that you could keep in mind for each pitcher, just so that you could kind of adapt on the fly and keep that in your head as you went up to the batter's box, but it wouldn't be so distracting.
Overwhelming. Yeah. Right. I mean, that's frustrating to me as a reporter when I've got extra information I want to tuck into a story. I can't even imagine all the homework you do when you're running a team and all the insights you've got, but that you have to kind of limit it so that someone can actually contain all that stuff. So I can only imagine. Ben Falk, I wanted to ask you as a guy, again, who worked for the Blazers and the Sixers in the front office and now coaches high school basketball. I mean, there are probably all sorts of things that you glean from working for an NBA team that then when you coach a high school team, you know, you don't necessarily have a professional talent out there. What sorts of things translate, and then what sorts of things have you found do not necessarily translate from one level down, not even to the next level, but two levels down?
Yeah, so I think that, honestly, I think what translates the most is just a framework of how you think about it, how you think about the game, and how you analyze the game. The specifics of it, I think it's very hard to know exactly what translates without a lot more data. And so, you know, we were talking about this earlier. Dean Oliver, I think, said a while back, you know, he has this framework of looking at the game through the four factors. That's a framework that can apply to the game on any level. But how you weight the four factors, right? Like, what is most important changes based on the context. So at the high school level, the talent is a lot worse. There's a lot less shooting. There's a lot more zone. There's a lot more pressure defense. And so it seems to me that, you know, I don't necessarily have the data to back this up, and I think this is what Dean was speculating, but it seems to me that offensive rebounding, rebounding in general matters a lot more, and turnovers matter a lot more. And so, you know, on the NBA level, those are actually things that have been de-emphasized as the skill level has exploded.
Nobody offensive rebounds anymore. Right. They just want to get back on defense.
Right. And so you have a very different game, and I think it's a mistake to necessarily say that you can apply these lessons from one level to the other, but you can apply that method of analysis, right? Like how you think about the game and how you approach making those decisions.
John, wanted to ask you, and some of this might not be doable just this minute, because if it was, maybe there'd be answers for it already. What do you see as the future of the tracking that you guys do? If you look, if you were to be asked 5-10 years in the future, what sorts of things do you feel like you'll be able to analyze or that you hope to be able to analyze that aren't there just yet?
Yeah, great question. And, you know, we're excited about the speed at which we've already progressed it. So to you know, imagine what we can do in the next 5 to 10 years, equally exciting. I think part of what the NFL and Zebra hopes to do is, and I think we talked about a little bit about this, is the means by which you communicate the data and help it become digestible. I think that equally from an important standpoint is there, you know, at the forefront. From the tracking technology itself, you know, we've already shrank the tag size more than 50% in just 2 years' time. So we've already went from evaluating the instrumented football at a Pro Bowl to implementing it on game day. And that's extremely rare. They don't, as you well know, they haven't made many changes to the football. So that's in my you know, opinion, a very significant leap forward. So in terms of where it can go, I think you're going to continue to see form factors that become you know, more athlete friendly. We're already using this solution on the players' compression shirts and practice jerseys. So no matter what they wear, whether they're indoor or outdoor, the teams will get that tracking data. So I think you'll continue to see those advancements, both in form factor and the speed at which the data becomes available, and then the means by which you make that data digestible to the particular user groups.
And that's, I guess, maybe the last thing I'll ask you is that what are you finding, or is it something you're even tracking right now, in terms of the literacy? I mean, people in this room probably understand the numbers that you guys are putting out there, want to put out there. I know for me as a writer who uses a lot of numbers, I'm always conscious or try to be conscious of the fact, like, I don't know who's going to understand this stuff.
Yeah.
Sometimes I can barely understand it when I first get the raw data. So making that digestible, what are you learning or what are you seeing about the level of literacy with regards to what you guys put out?
Yeah, so I had that that discussion this morning with one of the team members from the Panthers who stopped by our booth. And my genuine curiosity was, are you able to digest this data? Are you using the data? And they are. As for those of you who may know, may not know, the game is played, for example, on a Sunday. The teams will have their data available to them by noon the next day.
Wow.
And this includes everything from typical the player participation, from speeds that are run in a particular zone, just a tremendous amount of data to digest. And I was pleasantly surprised to learn that there are, most teams are using the data in some way, shape, or form. So in terms of digesting that, ingesting that, in some cases, teams are using the API and bringing it into their own player analytics tools that they've been using for years. In some cases, they're using either the portal provided by Next Gen Stats, by the NFL, or by our partner True Media. So it is exciting to see how many people are digesting it. I think you're going to continue to see, as time evolves and as the data becomes more interesting over time, I think you're going to continue to see teams find those, you know, those golden nuggets to help make differences on game day as they continue to use it.
Thank you. I guess one thing I was curious about with Mitch, I don't want to feel like I'm shortchanging any of the sports that we're talking about. I'm not totally knowledgeable about any of them necessarily. Maybe basketball I'm okay with, but what sorts of things do you feel like you guys really focus on other than just fourth downs? You know, obviously that's going to get the most scrutinized depending on what the outcome of that, but what else do you really feel like you're putting time and resources into to try to figure out probabilities, likelihood of what's going to happen, and what sorts of things keep you up at night aside from just a fourth down?
I may have to punt a little bit on that question, but I will say this. The framework that we look at is what is going to help us win. And if there are individual factors, which there we feel that there are, those individual factors, we're going to make sure we pay attention to those and monitor those and continue to measure them and make sure we're hitting certain benchmarks. So that's about as vague as I can be.
I'm going to get you guys in trouble. That was my goal coming up here. I'm a reporter. I have to get you in trouble. Ben Lindbergh. How did you feel about the way Andrew Miller was used in the playoffs this year? And by the way, I should add, some of these are audience questions, by the way, I think, right, that I'm taking. So some of these are from people on Twitter that are using the hashtag SSAC17. How did you feel about how Andrew Miller was used in the postseason? And are we kind of looking at a shift now in terms of the way that we should conceptualize what a closer is in Major League Baseball?
I think so, and it's really just things coming full circle. It's a shift back to what it used to be. And I think that in Miller's case specifically, it worked really well and it suited that team and that bullpen really well at that time. He was willing to embrace it, and he's a guy who has a long-term contract and he's made some money, and so the fact that closers are typically paid by saves, or at least historically that has been the case, didn't matter so much to him because he'd made his money already. And in that bullpen, you had a lot of guys willing to shift around and be used in non-traditional ways. And not everyone feels okay with that. And not every team has two or three guys capable of playing that role, really. You know, the Indians had two or three guys who were capable of being the closer. And so they had the luxury of bringing in Miller in the fifth or sixth inning because they knew they had another guy behind him. That doesn't work everywhere. And I don't think it works quite as well in the regular season. That worked really well for the Indians during the postseason last year because obviously there are more off days built into the schedule in October. And so you can work guys hard and they can still get their rest and come back. And over a 162 game season, that's a little tough. You have to worry about burning guys out. So I think right now we're at a point where you do see a lot of teams sort of flip a switch once you transition from the regular season to the postseason, and the schedule changes and the way that teams can use pitchers changes. And particularly for the Indians last year, who were shorthanded in the rotation at that time and had to compensate by getting more innings from their relievers, it made a lot of sense. And everyone was paying a ton of attention to it, and I think there has to be some trickle-down effect from that, but I don't think we're going to be seeing a lot of teams doing that routinely on April 1st. It's going to take some time, and you'll see some slight erosion with that rigid closer role, and more, I think, once you get to October, teams realize they have to pull out all the stops. There's nothing to save these guys for. They are going to have 6 months off, and you can work them really hard at these moments that matter a lot.
Kind of like a racehorse almost.
Right.
Yeah. So one other one for, I actually think this would probably be a good question for both Ben Falk and for Sam. So why don't we start with Sam? This one's from Twitter as well. Do you include coaching style in performance models and in player output? So when you look at how guys perform and how stuff is going, how much of the way that the person coaches a team do you take into account? And I can think offhand, someone who's very popular at the CIR conference, Mike D'Antoni, for years kind of had a reputation of coaching guys and the up-tempo style that they played, so guys' numbers would be, some people think, inflated in terms of their scoring because they're getting more shots. They're probably getting more open shots because of the fact that they play a five-out offense a lot of the time, or at least a four-out offense. But how much of that do you take into account, and how many ideas do you feel like you come up with that say that this works for this coach and hit the style that he prefers to play?
Yeah, it's a really good question. I think a lot of coaching style is dictated by player personnel, and a lot of player output is dictated by coaching style, and so there's this weird cycle of interdependencies that you have to account for. So it's hard to account for specific coaching styles whenever you're trying to evaluate a player, but it's definitely a good idea, and I think maybe with better data, you might be able to do a better job of that.
Hmm. Ben, do you have thoughts on that?
Yeah, I think, honestly, it's at the heart of a lot of proper analysis of players, is to understand the context that they're placed in, because you have to know, what is more core to the player that will translate to different scenarios, and, what is more contextual, mm-hmm. right? And so if you're acquiring somebody from another team, you have to know what's going to happen when the context changes, right? So what will translate and what might not. Right. And so a lot of analysis is trying to figure out, what context are they in, and maybe isolate that in certain ways so you can say, okay, maybe his pick and roll defense doesn't look good, but he's used in this style, and we think we play a different style, and when he comes here, right, he'll play differently because we're gonna use him differently, right? Versus saying this is what the player is as a defender, period, and just thinking about it that way and thinking that it might translate. So, particularly in basketball, context matters so much that you really have to take it into account. And, in terms of doing that systematically, I think, maybe a simple way to think about it is just to try to slice the data in certain ways that you can say, okay, now we're comparing performance in like contexts, right? Instead of trying to come up with some holistic model that accounts for it.
And I feel like that probably is a much different conversation in those sports as compared to baseball, where to some extent it's more individualized. We've got a guy up to bat and it's not as dependent on who's passing him the ball. There is no pass to be made and something like that.
It's still something to keep in mind, now that teams are using this new StatCast data to position players on defense. And so, you might take a guy who has poor defensive ratings and you can realize, oh, he's playing too shallow or he's playing too deep, and we can move him and he can stand somewhere else and suddenly he'll be an effective defender. So now you have to take into account, was it the coaching staff and the manager and the way that they were positioning the player, or was it his innate skill, and will that transfer if he moves from this team to that team? So it plays a part.
So even with that, there's more, it's thought of more than it would have been in the past because of those things. Sam, I'll ask you one more question based on what you'd said before. Does that then make it more difficult if coaching style and personnel has to be taken into account? I assume that makes it more difficult if the team, I can think of a team I covered in the not too recent past, the Knicks, for instance, turn their roster over almost every year. The Sixers obviously had a lot of turnover. Does it make it more difficult to account for a coaching style or for personnel when that personnel is changing frequently? Do you have to kind of change models or look at much different things than you did before from year to year?
Yeah, I mean, statistically, it would be hard to take that into account because specific, coaching strategies might change for a coach when the coach changes teams. If you're moving from a team with a lot of really skilled offensive players to a team with maybe a more defensive mindset, then coaches tend to adjust their strategies. So trying to, slap some label on a coach's overall strategies and then extrapolate that to projecting player performance would probably be a difficult and maybe bad idea.
Mitch, I tried to go away from the fourth down stuff for at least one question. but you guys did have a huge game, obviously. I think it was week 12 that you played against the Chiefs. There was a big fourth down that came up there. Is there stuff you can walk us through with regards to that game and what went into some of those decisions? It was a game against the Chiefs that the Broncos had that had a pretty big impact on the playoff race from that point.
Sure. So, like a lot of things, there were a lot of moving pieces. But week 12, I think both teams were 7-3. It was a Sunday night game. The game had gone into overtime. We had 4th and 10 from the plus, I think, 44. So, you know, a lot of teams kind of describe that as no man's land. It's a bad area of the field, primarily because there's a lot of things in play. The punt decision is certainly in play. If you have a strong enough, your kicker has a strong enough leg, a field goal is certainly in play. And then even going for it on fourth down is certainly in play. Unfortunately, things didn't work out for us, but, you know, kind of the lesson learned from that situation is there's times where you're forced to make a decision. You have to do something. And you know that all three options numerically are not great options. Fourth and 10 is not a real high percentage.
No.
Punting the ball after playing nearly 75 minutes of football against a divisional opponent at home.
Tired defense.
It sends a message to your team, whether you intend to or not. It certainly sends a message to your locker room. And then the last option, a kick and a field goal, is great. You get a chance to win the game, but haven't been a whole lot of 62-yard field goals. So, you know, just kind of the takeaway from the analytics perspective is you got a general baseline of what all those options probabilistically are, and none of them are very good, but you have to do something.
And in that case, too, I mean, you think about a field goal, and it's got to be tough to be in the spots that you guys sit in a lot of the time, too, because no matter what happens, well, if it works, then everybody thinks you're the greatest thing ever. When it backfires, everybody's looking to point a finger. I mean, at least in fairness with Denver, I mean, if someone's going to make a 62-yard kick, Denver is where it's most likely to happen.
Yeah, it was one of the more, like I said, one of the most challenging decisions I think we've encountered from a game, you know, kind of a game management standpoint, because there really were no good options. And obviously the missed field goal, the resulting field position, and then obviously KC ended up going down and kicking a field goal to win the game.
Mm-hmm. Sam, how would you say that you guys use analytics to determine who's going to be called up? Or is it more basic than that? Is it kind of how guys look and whether to bring them up from a lower level league, or are numbers being used and crunched for that? And is that, I assume some of that has to do with fit in terms of what the higher up team needs?
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of factors that go into that decision making process. So, I mean, the first thing to understand is that the data at the AHL level is not as good as the data at the NHL level, which shouldn't be surprising. So the amount by which we can use a quantitative approach to evaluate those players is limited, at least with respect to evaluating NHL players. But, you know, I mean, it depends on position, right? If you have a center getting hurt, you're probably calling a center up to replace him. If you have a winger getting hurt, then you're probably calling up a winger to replace him.
Sure.
But it definitely depends a lot on conversations with the you know, hockey operations staff in the American Hockey League. Which players happen to be playing well at that time, which ones have sort of earned the right to get the next call up. You know, that's a big moment for those players, and you know, you want them to just earn it instead of just sort of handing it to someone who,
sure,
you know, has the best some statistic that might not even mean anything when moving to the NHL.
And really, when you think about something like that, I mean, it's especially with basketball. I mean, it's crazy that you think that guys that are in the D League. One of my friends was asking me that, why hasn't this person been called up? They're averaging 20 a game in the D League. And it's like, well, a lot of people are doing that in the D League, and that's what some people criticize, is that the defense isn't quite at the level that it is in the NBA. And if you start rewarding just scoring and nothing else, then it kind of sends a message that the other things don't matter. And so that is interesting that you kind of look at fit and you look at the numbers part of it, but not just wanting to give someone something because they've attained one thing. So that makes a lot of sense. One question for John, because I use a ton of numbers. I feel like a lot of the numbers I use for basketball are from SportView, that does a very similar thing to what you guys do. It sounds like you guys have more data points than maybe what SportView does, but SportView in basketball tracks the movement of the ball 25 times per second, the movement of players 25 times per second. They use high-up cameras that track everything that happens on the court. You know, dribbles, how many times per touch someone is dribbling the ball. So I wonder, as other sports use more tracking data, are there things that you guys can glean from other leagues that that is either similar or much different that you guys have decided, you know, we want to look at this as it pertains to football? Or is it pretty much that the sports are so different that there's not a whole lot of overlap, or the things that do overlap would be very obvious?
No, I think there are certainly some similarities. I think the wide field of play that the NFL has creates some challenges, mm-hmm, for certain types of tracking systems. And I go back to the fact that the NFL had, you know, really done they had come to Zebra as an expert in tracking assets, right? The same type of technology that's being used on the NFL players for game day and practice has been used in tracking assets and inventory and even livestock in very complex environments. So they went through that rigorous evaluation and chose what worked well for them. In terms of other sports, we continue to see interest from the league, other leagues, other sports, in getting better granular data and getting it faster and getting it in real time. So I certainly think that there are complementing technologies. It doesn't necessarily have to be a one size fits all for mm-hmm. the sports, and I think we're gonna continue to see that evolve over time. And I think that, again, the digesting of this data and how it can be used for making decisions leading up to either game day or how do we rehabilitate a particular player. I think in a practice environment, it seems to be a little more conducive to use a solution similar to what we provide because it's really hands-off. You simply activate the players, they hit the field, and they track the data. And for every player on the field, no matter how large the roster, you're able to track that same data regardless of where they are. So I think from that standpoint, we certainly have some advantages. I think that's one of the reasons we were selected to do the project. And again, I think we can continue to learn things from other sports in the tracking technology that they use as well.
And I think we might just have time for one more question or so. And this one will also go to you if that's okay.
Yep.
I know Mitch would probably love this if it could be done, but how long do you feel like it would take or it will be until maybe even XY coordinate data and tracking data could be used to help a coach decide whether he wants to call a challenge on a play? Is that something that in the future yeah. could be realistic? Or like you said, it's still pretty quick turnaround, the fact that you guys are able to get stuff to teams the next day, by noon the next day, or whatever it is. But are we looking at potentially having that sort of thing in the future where it's real time?
Yeah, that's an excellent point. And it's something that's come up in the context of officiating as well, right?
Okay.
In terms of the spot of the ball. The precision with which we can track is sub 6 inches, which is great. We can, again, deliver that information either to the booth or the broadcaster in 100 milliseconds. So I think all of the components are there. It brings up a much bigger question, though, and that is, I can't believe I'm diving into this, but the role of the official, and would we ever potentially either aid or augment, I don't want to use the other word, I don't think that's going away, because I think there's an emotional element that officiating brings to the game, which isn't going away anytime soon. In terms of how that data can be used on the sideline to help potentially make a decision on whether or not to challenge, I absolutely do think it could be considered. Hmm. And I think you're continuing to see, again, with the use of the data, even immediately post-game, we're seeing more and more use of that and faster. So there could be a day where that could be feasible, sure.
I will tell you this. I know this is college level. You guys are doing stuff with the pros. We could have used you in that Michigan-Ohio State game that we lost on that on that running play. We really could have used you at that point. We would have had a playoff berth because of that. But
for sure.
I think we might be out of time at this point, but thank you guys so much. I know I learned a ton from it as a basketball guy, but thank you so much for being here and for participating in the panel today.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.